So welcome to this session on tongue. Tongue is located in the oral cavity and has following parts. If you see it in the sagittal section, this is the mandible. And here is the hyoid. And this is how the tongue looks like in a sagittal section. So this is mandible. This is hyoid. Running from mandible to hyoid, this part is called as the root of the tongue. This part is called as the tip of the tongue. And this is the body of the tongue. This surface of the tongue is called as the dorsal surface. And this part of the tongue is called as the ventral surface. So tongue has a root, which is attached to hyoid and mandible, a tip, body has two surfaces, dorsal surface above and ventral surface below. If you look at the ventral surface, from below, we see the ventral surface is attached to the floor of the mouth by a frenulum, okay? And then here on the ventral surface, we also see the lingual veins. Here, we see this frenulum just continuing as a fibrous plica. And if you see the dorsum of the tongue, normally the dorsal of the tongue may show a median furrow. So these are the external features of the tongue, the root, the tip, the body, ventral surface, frenulum, dorsal surface, median furrow. Now talking about the details structure of the tongue, the tongue has mucosa, the mucosa of the tongue shows papillae, the tongue has muscles, is made up of muscles. These muscles are of two types. Intrinsic muscles and extrinsic muscles. The intrinsic muscles of the tongue are again four. And extrinsic muscles are four. Let us study the extrinsic muscles first. By the word intrinsic, we mean that the muscle takes origin inside the tongue and the insertion is also inside the tongue. By extrinsic, what we mean is the origin is outside and insertion is on the tongue. Okay. Now the first muscle, genioglossus. The origin of the genioglossus is from the upper genial tubercle of the mandible. Now this is the mandible, you are looking in a sagittal section. There is upper genial tubercle and lower genial tubercle. From the lower genial tubercle takes origin the geniohyoid muscle. From the upper genial tubercle takes origin the genioglossus muscle. Okay. The fibers run right up to the hyoid. But origin is here. This is the origin. So whenever it contracts, it pulls the hyoid forwards and it pulls the tongue forwards. It has three types of fibers. These are the inferior fibers. Then these are the middle fibers. And these are the anterior fibers.
Okay.
action of the anterior fibers is it retracts the tip. It doesn't retract the tongue, it only retracts the tip of the tongue. Tip of the tongue. Middle fibers, they depress the tongue. But whenever you are writing the actions, you have to write the action of the inferior fibers first, because that's the most important. Inferior fibers, they inferior fibers, they protrude the tongue. Protrude the tongue. And because it protrudes the tongue, it prevents the tongue from falling backwards. And that's why it is called as the safety muscle of the tongue. This is your MCQ. Safety muscle of the tongue. What? Genioglossus. The second muscle is hyoglossus. Hyoglossus, if you see it in the side of the tongue, here is the hyoid bone. Okay, smaller corno, greater corno. And the hyoglossus, the fibers, they take their origin and go to the tongue like this. From tongue, from hyoid to the tongue. So therefore, whenever it contracts, it will depress the tongue. Depress the tongue, hyoglossus. Now, if you see muscle number 3 and 4, which is styloglossus and palatoglossus, they come from above. Like suppose this is the tongue, styloglossus, it comes from the styloid process. Okay, it comes from the styloid process. So its action will be, it elevates the tongue. It elevates the tongue. Same thing applies with palatoglossus. Palatoglossus will also elevate the tongue. So these two muscles elevate the tongue during the deglutition. So during deglutition, we want to push the food to go behind. So the tongue becomes like this, elevated, and then the food falls in the pharynx. So elevates the tongue. Now, the intrinsic muscles of the tongue. There are also 4. The intrinsic muscles of the tongue are also 4. And we'll have to take different sections of the tongue to see these muscles. But if you want to show them in a single section, they look like this. Tongue, of course, has a median fibrous septum. So in between, dividing it into 2 parts. So this muscle, is verticalis muscle. Verticalis. So whenever it contracts, the tongue will become flat. The first muscle we saw was verticalis. So whenever it contracts, the tongue becomes flat. Two is the horizontally running muscle. Now this muscle, it runs like this. So whenever it contracts, the tongue becomes round. The horizontal, this is the horizontally running muscle. This is the transversalis muscle. So tongue becomes round. transversalis muscle. So verticalis, the tongue becomes flat because when they contract, tongue will become flat. This, when it contracts, the tongue will become round. Three. Superior longitudinal fibers. They are running like this. If you look at the tongue, the superior longitudinal will be running like this. Okay. So when they contract, they make the dorsum of the tongue convex. Make the dorsum of tongue convex. Concave. Make the dorsum of the tongue concave. So this is how the superior longitudinal muscle. So whenever it contracts, it will make the dorsum concave, and there will be inferior longitudinal. So whenever it contracts, it makes the dorsum of the tongue convex, right? Because it is on the lower side. So it makes the dorsum convex. Dorsum of the tongue convex. So superior longitudinal, inferior longitudinal muscle. So I have told you the action of genioglossus. It is protrudes the tongue. Hyoglossus depresses the tongue. Styloglossus, palatoglossus elevate the tongue. Verticalis makes the tongue flat. Transversalis makes the tongue round. Superior longitudinal makes the dorsum concave. Inferior longitudinal makes the dorsum convex. So that is about the action of the tongue. Now going to the details of the structure of the tongue, we can study it more by histology. So as we said, the dorsum of the tongue looks like this, and firstly, I'm just talking about the gross structure, which has to be described before describing the muscles, of course. The dorsum of the tongue has an anterior part, which is called as the oral part, and a posterior part, which is called as the pharyngeal part. Okay. And this sulcus, which divides it, is called as sulcus chiasmaticus. Sulcus chiasmaticus. The oral part shows papillae. Many types of papillae. There are circumvallate papillae, which are located here. Circumvallate papillae. Then there are filiform papillae located all over. Then there are small fungiform papillae located more at the tip and sides. There are few foliate papillae. So circumvallate papillae, filiform papillae, fungiform papillae, and foliate papillae. This fungiform papillae have taste buds. Circumvallate papillae have taste buds. Filiform papillae, they don't have taste buds. Rather, they are covered with keratin. Their main function is to make the tongue rough. Make the tongue rough so that the food doesn't slip. On the posterior part of the tongue, which is the pharyngeal part, there is something called as lingual tonsil. Lingual tonsil. And then comes the posterior most part of the tongue, which is connected to the epiglottis by median it is connected to the epiglottis by median and lateral. Glosso, which starts for tongue, stands for tongue. Epiglottic, glosso epiglottic folds, and the space in between is called as valicula. Valicula. So this is tongue. This is epiglottis. You are looking from the top. This is median glosso epiglottic fold, and these are the two lateral epiglottic folds, glosso epiglottic fold, and this is the valicula. The circumvallate papillae histologically, when we see, draw it like this. So this is one papilla innervated by nerve. And then here in the sulcus, this is the sulcus. There are one Ebner's glands. One Ebner's glands. Now these glands are the ones which secrete the secretion, and whatever we eat, that food mixes with this secretion and acts on the taste buds. And that's how we feel the taste. So whenever we get fever, the warm Ebner's glands, they fever, they dry up. So we don't get any taste for whatever we are eating. Therefore, a sick person may prefer to have fruit juices, because the juice can directly go and act on the taste buds. But whenever you eat solid foods, the secretion of the warm Ebner's glands is needed, which dissolves with the food and then acts on the taste buds. Now, histologically, whenever we draw the tongue, this is how classically we draw it, and then we show the papillae, right? We show the papillae, mucosae. Then the muscle is striated muscle, and muscle fibers are literally running all over the place. Then there are arteries seen. Okay, so a few arterioles will be seen here and there. Okay, and here is the mucosa, submucosa. Epithelium is stratified, squamous, non-keratinized epithelium. Stratified, squamous, non-keratinized epithelium. So that is about the histology of the tongue. This is how classically even it looks under the microscope also. Now we go to the development of the tongue. All of us know that there are six pharyngeal arches, and when we look at those pharyngeal arches from inside part, where we see the endodermal pouches, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So what happens is, in the first arch, there is a mesodermal thickening in, of course, in the center, which is called as tuberculum impar. And then by the side, also there are thickenings. Okay. And these thickenings are called as lingual swellings. So these are the lingual swellings. And we look, and this is the tuberculum impar. Lingual swellings. Tuberculum impar. And then in the second, third, and fourth arch, there is a thickening called as hypobranchial eminence. Hypobranchial eminence. So at the end, now what happens is, we have two lingual swellings. There is tuberculum impar, and there is hypobranchial eminence. Lingual swellings, tuberculum impar, these are all developed from the first arch. And this is developed from second, third, and the fourth arch. This is the hypobranchial eminence. This hypobranchial eminence is divided into a cranial part, and caudal part. Cranial part and caudal part. This cranial part contributes to posterior 1/3 of the tongue, and the caudal part contributes to formation of epiglottis. And that is why the tongue is connected with the epiglottis by glossoepiglottic fold, because both the posterior 1/3 of the tongue and the hypobranchial eminence, both of them, they develop from the hypobranchial eminence, epiglottis and posterior 1/3 of tongue, and therefore they remain connected with each other by glossoepiglottic folds. Now, normally we feel that development of tongue is complete if we say that anterior 2/3 of the tongue develops from the lingual swellings. So these are the lingual swellings and tuberculum impar. And posterior 1/3 of the tongue develops from the cranial half of hypobranchial eminence. But that doesn't complete the description. We have to add one more thing, that the muscles of the tongue, they develop from occipital myotomes. Okay. All of us know about the somites. The somites are formed from paraxial mesoderm. Paraxial mesoderm forms the first somite on the 20th day, and after 21st day, every day 3 somites are produced. Each somite further gets divided into sclerotome, myotome and dermatome. So from the occipital myotomes develops the muscles of the tongue, and from the preoccipital myotome develop the muscles of the extraocular muscles of the eyeball. Therefore 3, 4, 6 and 12, these nerves supplying these extraocular muscles and the muscles of the tongue, they are supply, they have this component, general somatic effect. Okay, so development of the tongue, we have to talk about how the anterior 2/3 develops from the lingual swellings and tuberculum impar, how the posterior 1/3 develops from the cranial half of the hypobranchial eminence. And we have to also write the muscles of the tongue develop from occipital myotomes. That will complete the description about development of the tongue. Now, talking about the next component, that is the nerve supply of the tongue. Nerve supply of the tongue, better to make a table. Okay, to write the part of the tongue, what carries the general sensation, what carries the taste sensation. So anterior 2/3, general sensations by lingual nerve. And taste sensations by chorda tympani. Chorda tympani nerve, which is a branch of fascia. Okay. Posterior 1/3, general sensation is by glossopharyngeal nerve, and taste is also by glossopharyngeal nerve. And posterior most part, general sensation is by vagus, and taste sensation is also by vagus. And it is the posterior most part, if you see the parts of the tongue, the tip normally is the tongue buds, or at the tip they appreciate the sweet sensation. So therefore we have a tendency to eat the ice cream always from the tip. The sides, the start, the spicy sensation. Therefore whenever we eat something very spicy, we start moving the tongue sideways like this, saying that. And the posterior most part, you know, it appreciates the tastes of the wine, alcohol. And therefore, whenever people, they drink alcohol and wine, they gulp it so that it hits the posterior most part. Whenever a drunkard also drinks, he also holds the bottle high up and drinks so that the wine and alcohol entering is hitting the posterior most part where the sensation of alcohol is appreciated. Regarding development, we are looking at the tongue from the side. Now this is the anterior two third, and then this is the posterior one third, which is developed from the second arch and the third arch. Okay, so this is anterior to third developing from the first arch and second arch, third arch, fourth arch. Now what happens is this third arch overgrows over the second arch. Okay, so the third arch literally overgrows over the second arch, and that is the reason that although the posterior one third is developing from second, third and fourth arch, the second arch nerve, the facial nerve, doesn't contribute to the nerve supply of the posterior one third. Rather, it overgrows and almost spills over the sulcus chiasmaticus little bit on the surface area. And therefore, because it spills like this, the nerve of the third arch, the glossopharyngeal nerve, will supply the posterior one third, and it will also supply the circumvallate papillae. It will also supply the circumvallate papillae. Okay, so the reason you should know that the third arch, it overgrows over the second arch, and therefore the posterior one third is supplied by the third arch now. And while overgrowing, it slightly spills over the sulcus chiasmaticus and also supplies the circumvallate papillae. Now the nerve of the first arch, the first anterior to third develops from the first arch, and the nerve of the first arch is the mandibular nerve, and lingual is a branch of the mandibular nerve. But then why does it get a branch called as corda tympani, which is actually a branch of the second arch? Okay, so such branches like corda tympani, which is actually a branch of the second arch, but supplying a structure developed from the first arch, is called as pre-traumatic nerve. Pre-traumatic nerve. Okay, now suppose this is arch number one. This is arch number two. So arch number one is supplied by mandibular nerve. Arch number two is supplied by facial. Okay. So tongue anterior to third develops from arch number one. So should have been supplied by mandibular nerve only via lingual. But the facial nerve gives a branch called as corda tympani. Corda tympani. And this corda tympani is called as a pre-traumatic branch. Pre means previous. So the nerve gives a branch to the previous arch. And this concept is called as pre-traumatic nerve. Also, the nerve of the third arch is glossopharyngeal. So there is a concept that glossopharyngeal gives a branch called as tympanic branch, which supplies the second arch structures, like the structures developing from the tubotympanic recess, which develops from the second arch. But this concept is not so common. So example of pre-traumatic nerve is corda tympanic nerve. The blood supply of the stomach, of the tongue, comes from the lingual artery. Okay? All of us know external carotid artery gives three anterior branches, superior thyroid, lingual and facial. So lingual is the main. Then some branches from the tonsillar artery and all also join. The venous drainage is by the lingual vein, which drains into the internal jugular vein. The lymphatic drainage is different for different areas. Suppose this is the tongue, the tip, it will drain into submental lymph nodes. Okay, anterior two third drains into submandibular lymph nodes, and posterior one third drains into the jugulodigastric lymph nodes, which are the main lymph nodes of the tongue. Jugulodigastric lymph nodes, main lymph nodes of the tongue, because all this lymph ultimately will go to the jugulodigastric. Jugulo-omohyoid lymph nodes are the main lymph nodes for the larynx, while zygolo-digastric lymph nodes are the main lymph nodes for the tongue. So at the tip of the tongue drains into submental, the anterior two-third drains to submandibular, posterior one-third into zygolo-digastric, and all the lymphatics of the tongue ultimately go to the zygolo-digastric lymph nodes. Now coming to the last component, that is the applied anatomy of the tongue. Firstly, we always write about congenital anomalies. And in this is an anomaly where frenulum is very short, so short. You know, frenulum, we initial part we studied frenulum. Frenulum is a structure which is on the ventral part and it attaches the tongue to the floor of the mouth. Okay, so when this frenulum, short frenulum is there, this short frenulum leads to a condition called as tongue tie. So because of this short frenulum, person is not able to speak so much because the movement of the tongue gets restricted. A small tongue is called as microglossia. A large tongue is called as macroglossia. Okay. So that is about the congenital anomaly. Second, we talk about investigation. Of course, the tongue, there is nothing like investigations. Rather, tongue is a source of information. Source of information during investigation, not investigation, during physical examination. Okay, so it tells us about hydration of the body. If the tongue is moist, that person is hydrated. It tells us about the hemoglobin status. If the tongue is pale, the hemoglobin is less, person has anemia. Okay. Now, medical issues with the tongue, the inflammation of the tongue is called as glossitis. Very common in B12 deficiency. So whenever we get ulcers on the tongue, the stress ulcers or any ulcers due to vitamin B12 deficiency, or in general, the ulcers of the tongue respond very nicely to this B12 tablets, vitamin B12 tablets. So whenever we get some ulcer on the tongue, we take this vitamin B12 tablets for ulcers of the tongue. The surgical removal of the tongue is called as glossectomy. It can be partial, it can be total. And this happens in the our fifth thing we discuss is cancer of the tongue. Cancer of the tongue is formed by is caused by factors starting with S, sharp tooth. So if a sharp tooth is again and again hitting the tongue, that inflammation can cause cancer. It can be caused by spirit, tobacco, smoking, all of this does affect the tongue. It can be caused by syphilis. The sexually transmitted diseases sometimes are there in the seen in the oral cavity also. So the person can get syphilis, and that, of course, now this cause I should not speak about, because syphilis has become, it responds very nicely to treatment. But these are some of the causes of cancer of the tongue. Loose fitting dentures, and which are, you know, again and again causing tongue bites. That also is one of the cause of the cancer of the tongue. So that is about the applied anatomy, congenital anomalies, microglossia, macroglossia, short frenulum leading to tongue tie. Investigation, tongue is a source of information during physical examination, like hydration, lets us know about hydration, hemoglobin. So therefore, whenever you have been to the clinic since your childhood, the first thing the doctor shows that jeep dikhao, show your tongue. Medically, inflammation of the tongue is called glossitis. This happens most commonly in B12 deficiency. Stress ulcers, very commonly seen on the tongue. Now, whenever you will become exam going, and if you study hard and don't sleep in the night, very commonly there is ulcer developed on the tongue. And then what a person has to do is just take vitamin B12 tablets. Glossectomy, it is the removal of the tongue, partial or total, mainly done during cancer of the tongue, which is caused by S factors starting from S. Sharp tooth, spirit, syphilis, loosely fitting dentures, they cause tongue bites. So I stop here with my presentation on tongue. Thank you so much.